My name's Dan Rivera. I'm the mayor of the city of Lawrence and a member of the advisory group for the Ellen Swallow Richards lecture series and organization. And I have the great pleasure of opening up, but also to MC for most of the evening. I am awful at science, so I'm not going to pretend I have any idea about the subject matter, but I will tell you that as a Lawrence kid, knowing that greatness and the importance of the things that happened here in Lawrence that came out to have helped the rest of society, kind of makes me feel like what we know about our city, that great things come from here. So it is right, and it's about time that we do have a thing that looks at the work of Ellen Swallow Richards and says this is an important piece of Lawrence history. So I'm blessed, every day I'm blessed to be the mayor, and every day I get a chance to do something great in support of something like this, and so this is one of the special ones for me. I want to just start off by introducing a person who I think none of us would have come to push this through if it wasn't for a friend of ours and also a member of my, this is falling, sorry. A member of the Historical Commission here in Lawrence, my friend Chad Montre.
Well, I'm very excited that we have such a great turnout for what is the first Ellen Swallow Richards lecture, and hopefully the beginning of many more. I'm just going to say a few things about the group of people that put this together to thank them, and then we'll get started with the program. This is part of a larger project that we're doing that has sort of a focus on the history of the Ferris Park site, which is the new park groundwork Lawrence created. Which, as you'll find out, as I think many of you already know, is the former site of the Lawrence Experiment Station. And that project is supported by a grant from the UMass President's Office, what's called a Creative Economy Grant. I also want to thank the folks at Groundwork Lawrence, especially Brad Buescher, Stephanie Cross, and Leslie Melendez, the people at Essex Arts, John Budzina, and Marianne McArdle, and the folks at Lawrence Heritage State Park, especially Jim Boucher. And they're all part of the group that is working on the Urban Waters Revolution project. And then also by student Daniel Bazarian, who's here, who's sort of doing, he's in the back, doing a lot of the groundwork for the things that we're up to, like this lecture series. As you have seen, we have very good food and drink, and that is provided by Bell Tower Cafe. And I want to thank the people on the program, some of whom came some distance to get here and brave their way through traffic. Mayor Rivera, Congresswoman Nikki Tsongas, Mary Ann Paley, Oscar Pancorbo, and Dr. Susan Solomon, our featured speaker. And Danny's going to introduce each of those now in turn.
So next up, a person that I would not be here as mayor in front of you if it wasn't for her support. But I think that a lot of us could probably say that we would probably not have had something going on in our lives if it wasn't for the support that she gives us as our congresswoman. And Nikki Tsongas for me is a very important person, again, because we talk a lot about political courage, and some people think it's an oxymoron, but I think every day that she goes to Congress and represents the city of Lawrence and the rest of the 3rd District, she shows that. And that's not just the work she does for communities like Lawrence and Lowell in economic development, those things, but also the work she's done on the armed services subcommittees dealing with sexual assault in the military and making sure that women have the right body armor. And so it's always a pleasure to introduce my my congresswoman, Nikki Tsongas.
Thank you, Dan, and it's always a pleasure, truly a pleasure, to come to Lawrence and to be a partner with all of you in this room and with your mayor, who I was proud to endorse when he sought this seat and have been so honored to work with since he was successfully elected. So, and I look forward to continuing to work with him. It's not every day that you come to a lecture series where you have such great food, I'm having a hard time resisting it. But obviously, it's really my pleasure to join you all at the premier installment of the Ellen Swallow Richards Annual Lecture, which is to be given today and kicked off by a very esteemed and accomplished scientist, Professor Solomon. I'm sorry I won't be able to stay to hear your presentation, but I have no doubt that it will be quite interesting. Ellen Swallow Richards was truly a woman. She was determined to lead her way, and there was nothing to lead the way, and there was nothing that was going to stop her, and she used her knowledge and education to benefit others. But she is like so many other great women who were in the forefront of progress, who came from the 3rd District of Massachusetts, which I represent and which Lawrence is a part of. The Lowell Mill girls embraced the opportunity to enter the workforce during the Industrial Revolution. While in Lawrence, women and young girls took a leading role protesting for fair wages and inhumane conditions in the Bread and Roses strike of 1912, which started right here in this mill building. And I have a picture that I love in my office in Washington that shows those brave women who took part in that and who really led to changing some vast changes in our labor laws. Edith Norse Rogers, who preceded me a number of years back, a good number of years back, became the first woman elected to Congress from New England and served for 35 years representing this region. She was from Lowell, but she held that seat for 35 years and still holds the record as the longest serving female member of the House of Representatives. During her time in Congress, she co-authored the original GI Bill, which has provided much needed benefits to countless American service members, and she was the chairwoman of the Veterans Affairs Committee in the House of Congress, in the House of Representatives. Abolitionist Lucy Stone was the first woman to graduate from college in Massachusetts and gave her first major speech in Gardner in 1847. And in case you didn't know it, Gardner is now part of this district. With redistricting, it now goes out west, and Gardner is the last major community out that way, a wonderful community as well. She worked alongside historical figures William Lloyd Garrison and Susan B. Anthony. But perhaps Louisa May Alcott said it best when speaking of women breaking barriers. In 1880, Louisa May Alcott, a contemporary of Ellen Swallow Richards, was the first woman in Concord, Massachusetts, which is also in this district, to register to vote after the legislature gave women the right to vote, but only for school committee members. After taking that radical step, she wrote, quote, "No bolt fell on our audacious heads, no earthquake shook the town," unquote. Indeed, the women from this district have done remarkable things and deserve recognition for their many contributions to our nation and their communities. And I see that as I look around the room. I can say that with certainty this current generation of 3rd District women is not slowing down, and nowhere is that more true than here in Lawrence. Women in this room are leading nonprofit and community development organizations that change the future for the next generation. They are leading cultural institutions that enrich our lives on a daily basis and protect our historic treasures. They are growing businesses, serving in professions like medicine and law, developing real estate, and bringing advanced technology and high-value jobs to the area. And many of them, like Ellen Swallow Richards, just happen to be MIT alumni. So history has shown when women assume positions of leadership, they are able to draw more attention to issues that affect women and families as a whole. This was certainly true of Ellen Swallow Richards' remarkable work on water quality, which changed public health parameters for the Commonwealth and the world. And I think with all the events in Flint, Michigan, we see what happens when water quality is not dealt with and the devastating impact it can have, not least of all, on children. Water quality is a subject near and dear to my heart as my annual River Day, during which I celebrate and draw attention to the magnificent resource our rivers play throughout the district, is this Saturday. And this year, as in so many in the past, I'm happy to once again kick it off right here in Lawrence at the Spigot River Cleanup, that Groundwork Lawrence puts together every year. It's always a great thing to be a part of that, and especially see all the young people who come out to take part in it. Ellen Swallow Richards would be proud of what is being done to preserve and protect our vital waters by Groundwork Lawrence and its succession of amazing women executive directors. So the third district's rich tradition of women leaders is definitely motivation for the next generation to take risks, lean in, and engage in community and public service. I can't wait to see what all of you accomplish, and I'm sure that your kickoff speaker today will help to show you what's possible when we use our great minds and put them to work to address the problems this country faces. Thank you all, and enjoy your evening.
Thank you, Congresswoman Tsongas. The next person I'd like to bring up to speak is, when I think about the people in Lawrence that are making a difference every day, she's definitely one of them. But I'd like to just, if you guys can, anybody who's in the audience who owns a home, and you have to worry about your roof and your electricity and the windows, imagine if you owned this building and the worries of the roof and the windows and the electricity. And the ability to do that every day and not falter, and then have, I don't know if you've probably seen pictures of this on the roof, it's the length of the whole building, a solar array using solar power to run this place. And I just think it's one of those amazing things that I tell people all the time about the size of that solar array and how every day Marianne has to come to work and figure out how to keep this building going and help, and how that impacts our city. So our friend and the owner of the Everett Mill, Marianne Paley.
So welcome to the Everett Mills. And just as a, because I have the, because Chad asked me to speak, I get to give you the 1 second introduction to the Everett Mills. We are here anchoring Essex Street. We have over 50 businesses, all different kinds, manufacturing and educational resources and social services and professional offices and wonderful nonprofits. So welcome to those of you who haven't been here before, and learn more what we're about here. But tonight I'm really here as representing Groundwork Lawrence, and it's incredible that we're having this wonderful event here, because when I was the first executive director of Groundwork. Groundwork came out of a very innovative partnership between the National Park Service and the Environmental Protection Agency. And that partnership looked at how we could think about reclaiming brownfields and open spaces in cities that were really struggling, industrial cities, and how we could work with members in the community to envision a different future, and how investment in those open spaces could really change not only the places in which they lived, but their lives as well. And so for the last 15, 16 years, Groundwork has been doing just that work here in the city. And one of our first projects that we identified was the Ferris Park site, just across the street. And when I first walked onto that site and kind of walked through all the brambles and everything, and I got to the very end of the site, it was like being in an entirely different universe. It was on the confluence of the Spigot and the Merrimack River. There were cormorants and hawks flying around. You could hear the rush of the river, and you could hear the water coming over the dam that was built in 1845. And to look back at this site that really was just, no one ever went there really, except for a few fishermen who I hope now enjoy it more than they did then. But to think about where we've come in the last 15 years of bringing people together in the city to care about open space, and this open space in particular, to learn not only about what it could be as an urban wild and as a place where people could learn about conservation and natural resources, but to look back and connect that site to the heritage of the mill buildings around them and to the heritage of the experiment station and to the work of Ellen Swallow Richards. And then also to take what had been kind of an industrial site, because there had been a company there where what remained was a huge slag heap, but to take that and make an art form out of it that could bring people around this incredible hill and have amazing views out to the river. So just as one microcosm, this project, which took us 15 years to accomplish, and many partners, local and state and federal, maybe some federal partners too, and much support, became the capstone of a 3-mile Spigot River Greenway that touches neighborhoods all across the north part of the city. It became really an amazing resource for residents and students and visitors. So for me, it's the fruition of what Groundwork has always been about, which is changing lives and changing people and changing places, sorry. And so I appreciate this, all of you gathering, and enjoy looking forward to hearing the speaker. Thank you.
I got so caught up to saying such great things about Marianne, I forgot to say great things about Groundwork, and I just want to add my little bit to it too, and that is that we lean so much on Groundwork, from helping us do the charrettes on parks in South Lawrence, to helping us plant 2,000 trees or something like that, 2,400 trees, and when you have 6.7 square miles, it does become a problem about where you put the trees. And you know, if we didn't have that type of leadership over at Groundwork, it would, a lot of the things that we do with our green space would not get done. And that even goes to my favorite part, which is the Spigot River cleanup that's this weekend. One of the things that I lost as being mayor is to be able to roll up my sleeves and actually do the work, because I have to run around to all the sites. But I think it's one of the things that helps make Lawrence better every day. With us today also is the director of the Lawrence Experimental Station, where it is today in South Lawrence. And it's over there hidden behind South Broadway, and if you want to get some good food, there's a little place on the river. But if you blink, you might miss it, right? Because it's hidden behind there. So it's with us today, Oscar Pancorbo, director of the Lawrence Experiment Station.
I am. Well, thank you very much. On behalf of the employees of the MassDEP Wall Experiment Station, former Lawrence Experiment Station, I want to thank UMass Lowell, the city, for sponsoring this annual lecture series that in many ways keeps alive the memory of Alan Swallow Richards and a small band of scientists and engineers that worked at the Lawrence Experiment Station starting in 1887. It was during that first period between 1887 and about 1907, roughly 20 years, that some of the most remarkable work in water and wastewater engineering, and science and engineering, was completed. And if you ever saw pictures, you might see them on our website. The actual Lawrence Experiment Station at that time, which was at the confluence of the Merrimack and Spigot Rivers, was a little more than a shack. And yet, this world-class work was done at that facility. When the new Lawrence Experiment Station in 1953 was dedicated on Shattuck Street, Professor Gordon Fair from Harvard University, professor of sanitary engineering, spoke and at the dedication that was in December of 1953. And he stated, quote, "Many of the early studies of water purification and sewage treatment at the Lawrence Experiment Station are counted among the classics of sanitary engineering literature. Some of them were so fundamental and so well conceived that they've continued to be reprinted in books of sanitary engineering for half a century. Most important American laboratories for sanitary research, whether supported by federal, state, municipal, or university authorities, are linked in one way to another to Lawrence," unquote. The EPA Research Laboratory in Cincinnati, Ohio, has always been a pet peeve of mine, because they state in their literature that they were the first laboratory in the United States dedicated to environmental research, and which is not true. Lawrence was here long before the EPA laboratory in Cincinnati was established. Again, thinking of this old facility during that period, and when you consider The new Wall Experiment Station, a $32 million facility, it's hard to imagine how work could be done in such a place. But Hiram Mills, who was the founder of the station, had a philosophy which he stated, quote, invest research with men and women, brains, ingenuity, and teamwork. They are far more important than all the elaborate equipment and costly facilities. So it's very nice to see the continuation of that pioneering research tradition continuing in Dr. Solomon's research in atmospheric chemistry. So thank you again, and enjoy the day.
That's a $32 million facility over there? I'm gonna have to visit, because that's a pretty big deal. So to what you really came for, which is the lecture, I'd like to just start off by saying a little bit about our speaker. Dr. Susan Solomon is the Ellen Swallow Richard Professor of Atmospheric Chemistry and Climate Science at MIT. And Dr. Solomon is an internationally recognized leader in atmospheric science, particularly for her insights in explaining the cause of the Antarctic ozone hole. She's a member of the National Academy of Sciences. She won and received the national, I guess you don't win, you earn the National Medal of Science from President Clinton. This, as I said before, kind of a big deal, she discovered the ozone hole. I'll try not to make a joke about that. It's and people still doubt that it's there, right? So it's important that you know where it's at. It's another cool thing is this that she has, and I know there's always people use glaciers as kind of like a pejorative thing, don't move it. But she's got a glacier named after her, the Solomon Glacier in Antarctica. But I think that all kidding aside, when we think about celebrating Ellen Swallow Rich's work, I think that MIT chose befitting person to receive that professorship, giving her work in science. And we are so happy to have you in our first annual lecture series. Dr. Solomon.
So much. Thanks to all of you for being here. It's a pleasure to be in Lawrence, to have a chance to deliver the Ellen Swallow Richards lecture. I'm deeply honored to be asked to do this. I'm also tremendously honored to be the Ellen Swallow Richards Professor of Atmospheric Chemistry and Climate Science at MIT. When Ellen Swallow enrolled in MIT, she was the first woman to do so in the 1870s. But particularly for the young people in the audience, and I see a few future MIT students here in the second row, I just want to note that today MIT incoming freshman class is usually a little bit more than 50% women. I think last year's class was about 53% women. So we've come a long way, and Ellen Swallow, who then became Ellen Swallow Richards, was certainly part of taking us there. What I want to do today is honor her legacy a little bit by talking to you first about the ozone hole, which is, for those of you who don't know where it is, and I'm sure all of you do, that's it. It's really quite a remarkable feature, and I'm going to talk about the success story, really, that the ozone hole represents in environmental management. And then I'm going to talk about a different issue where we've had a more mixed record, and that is the issue of lead. Lead, as the Congresswoman noted, is tremendously topical at the moment because of what happened in Flint, Michigan. I'm going to talk some about that. I'm going to talk about lead in water, lead in plumbing. I'm also talking about lead in paint and lead in gasoline. Three very interesting and related issues. So first, to introduce you to the ozone layer very quickly. Ozone is a very important molecule for us because it absorbs ultraviolet light that would otherwise hurt us. You know, you've been sunburned, you know that too much ultraviolet is not good for you. And stratospheric ozone up here is what protects you from that. The ozone that you sometimes hear about, pollution ozone, oops, why did that happen? And I know what was on it, so I'll just keep talking. There's three kinds of ozone you might want to think about. The good ozone in the stratosphere that protects you from ultraviolet light. The bad ozone at ground level, which is what causes smog, and sometimes it can get downright ugly, like in Los Angeles. So I like to tell people they can remember all about ozone by thinking about a famous movie, The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly. The stratosphere is located about 12 kilometers above your head. So if you fly on a high-flying aircraft, you can actually get into the altitudes of the ozone layer, but only if you fly pretty high up. I was hoping that by now we would have that thing back, but I can actually see what's happening. No, it's just waiting. It's all right, I can go through it. So if you're exposed to too much ultraviolet light, it can damage your DNA, and it's coming back to us now. What ozone depletion doesn't do is to significantly contribute to the greenhouse effect. People sometimes mix up ozone depletion and climate change. Those are really two distinct issues. The thing about ozone depletion is it's a deeply personal issue because cancer is incredibly personal. So, and I think that when we talk about environmental issues, we are much better able to understand how serious they are when they have an impact on us personally, on our personal health, and I'll come back to that. So that's the first of three P's that I often tell my students about. I think there's three P's that dictate how well we do when we try to manage an environmental problem. One is how personal is it, the second is how perceptible is it, and the third is how practical is it. So I'll touch on those. The initial ideas about the ozone layer actually trace back to this scientific paper, which was published in a very famous journal, Nature, in 1974. What these two people pointed out was that chlorofluorocarbons, which were being added to the atmosphere at increasing rates, they were being used mainly in spray cans, amazingly enough, in hairspray and underarm deodorant. 75% of the use of chlorofluorocarbon at that time was for that. They're also used in refrigeration and air conditioning, but those were actually relatively small at the time. They pointed out that these molecules have very long lifetimes in our atmosphere. They live anywhere between 50 and 150 years, so they're just going to continue to build up, get up into the stratosphere where they can go through those chemical reactions which destroy ozone. O3 is ozone. And this actually carries a little message that even if you're interested in science, you should also be interested in English. And you should also really read your page proofs very carefully when you publish, because you never know when you're going to have a typographical error in a paper that 20 years later wins the Nobel Prize. That's actually what happened with this paper. So, and this is the actual reproduction. And you know, there's a few people standing, and my water bottle is on a chair, which is kind of silly. So if anybody would like to take that chair and sit on it, please feel free to come take it. Okay. There are actually a couple of more chairs up in the front also, I believe, that aren't occupied. I hate to see people standing all the time for lectures. Okay, so these guys were talking about reactions only among gas phase molecules, and they said that if we kept using chlorofluorocarbons at the rates we were using them then, that by 2100 we would deplete 3 to 5% of the ozone layer. Sounded like, well, 3 to 5%, but you know, for every 3% decrease in the ozone layer, you get a 6 to 9% increase in skin cancer, and of course, if you're one of those 9%, you're not gonna be very happy about it. Still, it was only a theory, it was far in the future. Gee, does that sound like some other problem that we hear a lot about these days? But then something amazing happened in a place where nobody expected it, and it was the discovery of the Antarctic ozone hole. It was really discovered by these ground-based records that were available from several different sites, but it was also well seen in these beautiful satellite images where you could see that a region twice the size of the continental United States was missing its ozone. I came along and said, gee, I think I might know why Antarctica is so special. It's not just gas phase chemistry that's involved. I don't want to talk about the chemistry in detail except to say that the key thing that happens is that some of the chlorine compounds that come from those chlorofluorocarbons that you spray on your hair can eventually get all the way to Antarctica. They can react together on the surface of a cloud, make molecular chlorine, which then breaks down in sunlight. That attacks ozone, and now you've had a conversion takes place from chlorine that's not damaging, that's sort of a reservoir for chlorine, to one that becomes activated for ozone loss. So it makes the chlorofluorocarbons much more damaging towards ozone than they would otherwise be. It happens right in the heart of the ozone layer. So that's what I suggested in a paper that was published in Nature in 1986. And in the middle of that year, I found myself on my way to Antarctica, along with 15 of my colleagues. We arrived in August of 1986 around noon. You can see how dark it is. Temperature was minus 40 degrees Celsius, which is the same in Fahrenheit, minus 40 Fahrenheit. And so that's just an incredibly cold, incredibly beautiful, incredibly wonderful scientific experience to be able to go down there and take measurements that help to show why there's an Antarctic ozone hole. So one of the things that my colleagues and I did was to launch ozone measuring balloons. What's neat about that is you can actually look at where the ozone is missing. So if you look at it in August when it's very cold, remember we're in Antarctica, so it's the opposite of northern hemisphere seasons. August is winter. This is a normal sort of ozone layer, kind of like the cartoon I showed you before. By the middle of September, as the sun comes back and drives the light drives the chemistry that's needed to deplete ozone, you begin to see it go away. And so by the time you get to about the beginning of October, you've destroyed essentially all the ozone in the layer where the polar stratospheric clouds form through that surface chemistry. So that's why there's such an extreme ozone loss in Antarctica. We also measured a host of other chemicals. I'm not going to talk about those at all tonight. I'm just going to say that they all told the same story. There were massive perturbations to the chlorine chemistry of Antarctica, which were definitely what was causing the ozone hole. And that's me again having a great time. Why is the Arctic different? Simply put, the Arctic is generally warmer. So in the north, the polar regions just don't get as cold as they do in the south. That's what ozone depletion can look like in the Antarctic, like I've just shown you. Sorry about that. Whoops. Can I not go back? Yeah. And that's what you get in the Arctic. Just not you get some depletion, but not nearly as much. So the nations of the world did something remarkable, something that they have a hard time doing on environmental problems. They got together and they decided to agree on a protocol to phase these molecules out. And so instead of having the amount of chlorine in the atmosphere continue to increase as it had been doing, in Montreal in 1987, they agreed to slow it down, then they agreed to phase them out, and now we are following pretty much the zero emission line. But remember, those molecules have very long lifetimes, 50 to 150 years, so once they're in the atmosphere, they'll stay there for a long time, and that's why this decay is slow. It'll take till about 2050 till the ozone layer is completely healed, but there are very, very good signs. I'm going to show you one in just a minute that shows we're on the way. We know there's no production going on anywhere in the world at this time. That includes China, that includes India. No country is making those molecules anymore. It was really quite an incredible success story. Which brings me to another one of the P's, which is practical choices. What happened was that it turned out, when people put their minds to it, that there were lots of other things you could do besides use chlorofluorocarbons. To clean electronics chips, for example, instead of using chlorofluorocarbons as solvents, amazingly, you could actually use lemon juice in most applications. You could get rid of do-it-yourself auto air conditioning kits. You could get rid of styrofoam that was blown with chlorofluorocarbons. You can still have styrofoam, you just put other blowing agents in it. So there were lots of practical choices that were made. So what motivated us to do this is many things. One of them is that in the 1970s and 80s, people were really, I think, much more in tune with the environment than I'm afraid we've become now. I think we might just be getting too busy and we need to slow it down and think about the environment a bit more. But another thing that happened was that citizens really engaged with this problem, and I just want to show you the tremendous evidence around that. So if you look at, this is a plot showing you the tons of chlorofluorocarbons sold in the United States, the rest of the world, and the total. You see something happen in the US around the mid-70s. Suddenly we started buying less chlorofluorocarbon. That didn't happen in the rest of the world. It slowed down and sort of leveled off, but it didn't drop like it did in the US. It's not because the Montreal Protocol was signed then. That didn't happen until 1987. It's not because the ozone hole was discovered. That didn't happen until 1985. It's because of that theory that ozone depletion might be a problem. And what that did was to get people interested. The consumers became interested, and they learned that they could do a really simple thing. They could take that stuff out of their medicine cabinet and replace it with that stuff. How hard is that, you know? So lots of people did it, and what it did was to put a tremendous pressure on the chemical industry in this country. What had been a very good business became a very bad business. So the bottom line really is that the consumers had a large role to play in motivating the country and the industry to think about doing things differently. It was really quite an amazing thing. Is it working? I showed you what I thought would be happening with chlorofluorocarbons. Here's what's actually happening. You can see that the amount of chlorofluorocarbon measured all around the world, that's two different chlorofluorocarbons. There's actually about six of them that really matter, but these are the two main ones. Both of them have turned over and they're beginning to drop. So let's talk about another problem. I want to particularly do this because this is the Ellen Swallow Richards lecture. I want to talk about lead. A problem where we've had a different kind of history. We've had some success and we've had some real problems turn up. And I think both of those things teach us a lot about how we need to attack environmental problems. How old is the lead problem? Much, much older than the chlorofluorocarbon problem. Some studies suggest that Pliny the Elder actually understood that the cooking utensils that were made of lead that the Romans used contributed to the fall of the Roman Empire. So that goes back a long way. Lead acetate is called sugar of lead. It actually tastes sweet. It's actually it was being added to wines as a sweetener in the 1700s. This guy identified it as the reason why people in Devonshire were getting sick, because they used lead weights to crush apples when they made cider in Devonshire. Of course, there was a lead skeptic who wrote a rebuttal to that problem, that suggestion. I mean, even back then, these people were all over the place. Really interesting. But by 1897, it was pretty clear that lead paint was bad. For example, here's an ad for a paint that is not made with lead and is non-poisonous. I guess by inference, then lead that is made with paint must be poisonous. And yet, it was still being sold. The reason that you use lead in paint is that it makes it nice and bright white. It also makes the paint flow nicely. It's something with color. It's one of the metals often bring colors to things. Chromium, for example, is what makes emeralds green, and lead, that kind of lead can make things white. Dutch Boy, of course, advertised their wonderful high lead content paint, white lead, great stuff, it lasts. And yet, as early as 1897, it was recognized that children were getting lead poisoning. They were becoming very, very sick, and six of them, in this case, studied by these two physicians, actually died. That happened because they nibbled the paint chips from their cribs. Lead is sweet, so it's not uncommon for toddlers to want to eat it. In Australia, in 1904, this gentleman who was in the Australian Health Service wrote this paper pointing out that painted railings and painted walls on those beautiful Australian, not just in rooms, but on the porches that are so common, the beautiful porches in Australia, was a primary source of lead poisoning. And so in 1921, the Australians led the charge to have a white lead paint convention to avoid the use of lead in indoor painting. And that was adopted way back then in 1921 by quite a few countries, Sweden, Austria, Poland, Australia, of course, but not by the US, the UK, or a number of other countries. One of the problems in the US was, whose job is it? who's in charge of this kind of issue? Before the 1970s, we didn't have a national entity responsible for this kind of stuff, for consumer products. What we had were local building codes, no involvement even at the state level, certainly none at the national level. A few communities, especially Baltimore, instituted measures to try to make it illegal to use leaded paint in interior walls, but they were the exception. It had to wait for there to be a mechanism in this country, and the mechanism that finally happened, in 1972, the Consumer Product Safety Commission was established, and in 1978, they banned the use of interior lead paint. You may know they've also banned, you know, things like lead. They're the ones who deal with lead in kids' toys and things like that. So the establishment of that national level entity had to happen before this long-standing problem could be addressed. We hear so many people who love to criticize federal mechanisms and federal structures, and yet when you talk about a problem like this one, it's pretty clear that the establishment of a national structure was critical. Still, we've let lead paint be used for many, many decades, many centuries. And so we have still quite a few homes where quite a few children are living that still have lead in them. This is actually a little bit old. This is from 1988, but there's still plenty of lead paint in homes. The problem is homes are going to last for decades or centuries, and there's a century-long legacy lead problem then. It's the lifetime of the consumer infrastructure that's the big issue here. When you talk about your spray can for your deodorant or hairspray, you know, you're not going to keep that stuff very long. You're willing and able to make a change pretty quickly. But if you've put the lead on the walls in your house, it's more difficult. One of the most important things to do if you have leaded paint in your home is actually to replace the windows, because it's when the windows are open and closed that the lead goes to dust and gets in the air and gets to the kids. Also, have your soil tested and make sure that the kids aren't playing in a dirty garden full of lead. Okay, because there's lots of lead in our soils, and I'm going to talk a little bit now about another way that it got there. So let's talk about lead poisoning, what it does to people. It can kill you, it can damage your kidney, it can reduce your IQ, it gives you behavioral and attention problems, it hurts your hearing. We don't really know how low is low enough. How little lead should we have and be unaffected? The answer might be pretty close to zero, we don't know. But what we do know is that it's very harmful to children. So we nonetheless allowed a lead additive to be added to gasoline, of all things. And amazingly enough, and just by chance, the guy who invented tetraethyl lead, which is the additive that was put into gas to improve engine performance, that chemist, Thomas Midgley, happens to be the same guy who invented chlorofluorocarbons. Who knew? You know, I mean, what a legacy this man had. But anyhow, so he invented this stuff. There was a brief controversy because some lead plant workers died in the early 20s. The Surgeon General became engaged, but he thought, well, we could go ahead and let lead be added to gas until we can be sure that there's really a problem. Well, how do we, you know, what does that mean? Until more people die? I mean, you know, it's interesting how we set these standards. But basically what they were thinking then was that it was just an occupational hazard. If you were working in a lead plant, you were at risk. But they believed that there was no overall environmental hazard out there, you know, in the air for people to breathe just because cars were spewing this lead out of the back of the tailpipe. And there were lots of reasons why people had a hard time kind of coming to grips with this. Some people said, well, it's natural. There's lead naturally in the environment. That's true, but it stays in the rocks and in the soil. It isn't volatilized the way that we've volatilized it by using lead the way we've used it. There were scientists who argued that the body can adapt by getting rid of anything it doesn't need. The body just naturally expels it. I'm going to come to that in a second. Well, maybe it's bad, but you don't know, we can't define a threshold for when it's too bad. So maybe we shouldn't do anything until science is good enough to tell you it needs to be less than this. Well, that's kind of silly, in my opinion. If we know it's bad, waiting for science to become perfect enough to tell you how little is going to cause you some level of problem seems kind of wrong. Senator Edmund Muskie of Maine, was a foremost proponent of environmental issues, a real leader in the environment. And he held hearings and tried to get people to talk about this. This is one of the scientists who was funded by the lead industry, who came in and said, well, you know, we've been working on this for a long time. Lead is an inevitable element, and it's in vegetation, it's in animals. There's no way that life has ever been able to escape the absorption of lead. So, you know, basically we shouldn't worry about it, it's natural. And he was also the proponent of the idea that we would get rid of anything we didn't know. Another man had a different view, Claire Patterson. He was not a lead scientist, he was actually a geochemist. And what he wanted to do was determine how old the universe was, and to do that very, very accurately. And the way that he tried to do that was by measuring lead isotopes, because those have very long lifetimes, and if you can actually collect a meteor, and by measuring the ratio of certain isotopes in that meteor, you can tell how old the meteor is, and also rocks in the Earth. But he began to realize that he wasn't getting the right answers, because there was too much pollution in the laboratory all around him. He began to realize that there was pervasive lead in the environment that was preventing him from measuring how old the Earth was accurately. And so this is kind of a quote from him. You know, think of Pigpen in the Charlie Brown comic strip. Lead is everywhere. So the lead from your hair, when you walk into my laboratory, is going to contaminate, in his words, the whole damn laboratory, just from your hair. Lead's coming off your clothing. And so he learned that he needed, if he was going to figure out how much lead there was in those meteors accurately enough to know the age of those meteors, he was going to have to do super clean chemistry, and that's what he did. But in doing that, he also realized that the argument that lead was natural was completely wrong. There was lead everywhere at that time, but it's not natural. It's the lead that we put there. And so typical, as of the 1970s and 80s, was not a natural level of lead. He thought that silent, subclinical lead poisoning was widespread. People weren't getting sick enough to be rushed to the hospital, but they were becoming quite damaged by the amount of lead. And one of the ways that he showed that was actually to go to Greenland and dig up an ice core and show that this is what happened to the lead in it as we go from 800 BC to the 1970s. You can see the tremendous spike associated with the time when people began using lead in gasoline. Epidemiology was developing at about the same time. The science of epidemiology also had to mature before people knew how they could figure these things out. And one of the people who did really pioneering work on this was a gentleman named Needleman. He collected teeth, so baby teeth from kids in Chelsea and Somerville, right here near Boston. And he also did a careful control for many different variables, things like how educated were the parents, how wealthy were the parents, where did they live. At this point, people, I'm very sad to say, had the view that, gee, really the problem, it's just because poor people, who were mainly black, were just not good enough parents to keep their kids from eating the paint, right? You know, the kids were you know, not being raised right. These kids that he looked at deliberately were all white. And what he showed was that there was poorer performance in school the more lead there was in their teeth. As people began to recognize this, U.S. school children were tested, their blood lead levels began to be tested, and it became clear that the percentage of high blood lead levels was much higher in poor black children than it was overall in all children, so, you know, 17% versus 68%, and then for an even higher level of blood lead 5 versus 31, and it became clear that it wasn't an issue by no means of parenting. It was simply because they were, first of all, probably living in homes that had more lead paint, older homes, and also because they were living near highways. A very important study was done of the blood lead levels in kids that actually looked at the distance of the residents of kids from the roadways, from major expressways, and looked at how much the blood lead levels depended on how close they were to the roadway. So if you were living 100 feet from the roadway, you know, lots of kids had very high blood lead levels. If you lived 200 feet from the roadway, it was not as bad. So that's the kind of thing that was shown there. And then the EPA was established in 1970 by President Nixon. And a few years later, the first reductions in lead in gas began as the EPA promulgated a rule to begin to phase it out. And a remarkable thing happened. As the lead used in gasoline went down, the average blood lead levels nationwide went down as well, in a perfect correlation. So you may remember the time from when you had your choice between leaded and unleaded gas. You may not know that at the same time, kids nationwide were being tested, and that's what was learned. So let me very quickly turn to the issue of lead in pipes and Flint, Michigan. I've only really begun to dig into this. I don't have the whole story about what happened in Flint, but I have a few things that I've learned that I want to tell you about because I think they're important for everybody to know. You probably know that the city of Flint had a money problem, and so it was imposed upon them, I think it's fair to say, that they would switch their water supply away from Detroit water to the Flint River. It was supposed to be a temporary cost-saving measure before they could hook up to a better source. A pipeline was being built, but it wasn't ready yet. As soon as the switch happened, a few weeks later, residents began to notice odors and an orange color in their water. Chlorine disinfectant was used because high bacterial levels were measured, so that was intended to kill the bacteria. By August of the same year, E. coli and some damaging side chemicals were found. A spike in Legionnaire's disease was later reported, and about a dozen people died of Legionnaire's disease. You may know that someone was convicted yesterday of, failure to perform their duty, a state epidemiologist, because they knew about the Legionnaire spike and I'm not sure if they tried to cover it up or what, but anyway. The orange color indicates corrosion of iron pipes. Lead was being corroded too, but that wasn't immediately acknowledged. It doesn't make a color. Where does the lead come from? Well, it could come from fixtures such as brass faucets and solder in the home. And some of the people who first began to worry about this were told, oh, it must be your faucets. It's not anything that we've done. But where it can come from also, and did come from in almost all the homes in Flint, were old lead service lines. So the water main for the city is here, your house is here. There's a so-called service line, a pipe that runs from the water main to your house. That's a service line. And many of those were made out of lead, despite the fact that we should have known not to do that centuries earlier. That's been done for many years. Lead service lines within the city of Boston are in known locations. This is a map from East Boston showing you in great detail every single house next to East Boston High School that actually has lead. That's what the yellow spots are. There were no records of which homes had lead service lines in Flint, so people didn't actually know which homes were the most at risk. The Michigan Department of Environmental Quality carried out testing of Flint homes for lead, as they're required to do. The most at-risk homes should have been the ones tested, but since there were no records of where those were, that wasn't always the case. And that was only the beginning of the problems with the lead tests that were done in Flint. Here's a statement by Mark Edwards, who's a professor at Virginia Tech and an expert in pipe corrosion. It's from an interview in Scientific American a few months ago. And he said, it's really simple. They didn't follow the law. According to the law, when you make this kind of a switch, you should have a corrosion control plan. And you really need to protect your pipes, your expensive infrastructure, which you haven't switched over because it costs too much money, from contaminating the water. And the way to do that is by adding orthophosphates, which would have cost about $100 a day. Instead, they simply didn't do it, and plus the Flint River had high chloride, 8 times higher chlorine than is normal or than was in the Detroit water. And it's corrosive. It's a road salt. And the combination of not following the law plus that really led to the problems. Why are lead pipes ever okay? Well, they're okay because when they've been used for many decades, they get stabilized by a lead oxide passivation layer. It builds up slowly over a period of years. And as long as you keep adding the phosphate additives, this stuff, to the water, keeps the water a little bit basic, won't let it get acidic. And under those circumstances, your passivating layer stays stable and your water will be okay. By the way, the pH, the acidity of water leaving the treatment plant in Boston is about 9, which is pretty basic, actually. So we decided as a nation that we were going to manage the lead pipe risk with chemistry rather than solving it by getting rid of those pipes. But what happened in Flint is that they didn't use the phosphate additives. They decided to try to save a few more bucks that way. Plus, the high chlorine in the river was a problem. They added chlorine as a disinfectant. That made the water even more corrosive. That's why it turned orange, because iron was released and lead was also being released. That passivating layer forms very slowly, so Flint's water will stay contaminated for a long time to come. How do we find out about the problem? Well, Michigan Department of Environmental Quality was required to conduct tests on Flint water, should have detected the lead. There's lots of reasons why they didn't. I've already mentioned that they didn't really sample the at-risk homes because they say they didn't know at all where they were. There could have been some probably more intelligent guesses made. They actually threw away some high numbers. They said, oh, those numbers are too high, they must be wrong. And they didn't pay any attention to them. They said those must be bad data, so we won't use them. And if they'd kept them, they would have really sounded the alarm a lot sooner. And even worse, residents were told to pre-flush their systems, you know, flush the toilet, run the water, before collecting samples, which is absolutely against the protocol. The water should have been left unflushed. So Michigan Department of Environmental Quality actually told the EPA in writing that they were using optimum corrosion control, which is adding phosphates, when they were not. And I find it really ironic that when you look at the reporting on this issue, many people try to blame the EPA. The EPA was not in charge. The Michigan Department of Environmental Quality was in charge, and they lied to the EPA. So here's the map of the Michigan Department of Environmental Quality test data, you know, with a couple of pesky bad points thrown away. Here's a map that Professor Mark Edwards generated. He actually went to Flint and started taking data himself. And the reason he did that is that this lady, that's Leanne Walters, she's a mother, and she was very worried about her kids who were starting to get sick. She called this guy at the EPA, and he started looking into it, began to realize how big the problem was, and he said, hey, you know, Mrs. Walters, you should call Mark Edwards. There he is. There they both are testifying, and get him to sample your water because something's really wrong. And so he came out there, and he not only sampled her water, he sampled all these people's water. You can see how much more thorough his measurements were than the Michigan Department of Environmental Quality measurements, and you can see the very high percentages of high lead. So what about the kids? Well, it took some doing to actually reveal what was going on with the children's blood as well. And that was actually done by this lady, who was a pediatrician, who began to become very worried. Kids in Flint were having their hair fall out. They were getting sick. A friend of hers said, gee, isn't there something you could do? And so, since she was at the Hurley Medical Center in Flint, she got all the blood lead data samples that people had done before and after the water switch. And she looked at the change in blood lead levels, and it's the blue versus the red. You can see that some children had very, very high blood lead levels, depending on where exactly they lived. And particularly the regions that Mr. Edwards had shown had the high water content lead, also the kids had very high blood lead levels. So she said, you know, it's actually doubled overall, and in some neighborhoods it's actually quadrupled, and of course the neighborhoods where the worst problems were the poorest, and usually the black neighborhoods. So what do we learn from all of this? Well, I think we learned that sometimes we can do good things about the environment. In the case of ozone depletion, I think the problem was perceptible and understandable to people. The science, I could show you, for example, those balloon measurements of where the ozone is missing. I can show you what the ozone hole looks like. People understood that. They understood the personal health impact. So the problem was perceptible, personal, practical solutions came into existence. Consumers and environmental groups turned away from chlorofluorocarbons. They gave up their spray cans before they even had to. That really kick-started the change. And the policymakers, I think, did a great job. I actually give industry some credit here. I've worked with the people from the chemical industry on this problem, at least. I think they've been quite fair. Not so in the lead problem, I think it's fair to say. The people who put lead in gasoline fought against it for a long time. There's still a few countries where they have leaded gasoline, amazingly enough. The UN's been trying to get rid of that for years, and it's not happened yet. But still, science played a big role in helping to move this along. The progression of understanding the medical effects, the advances in epidemiology that I talked about, geochemistry, amazingly enough, the age of the earth, and Dr. Patterson. Civil rights were important because people couldn't just pass this off as being a problem of the black community. The EPA phase out of lead in gas, because we have now got an EPA. The Computer Product Safety Commission phase out of lead in paint. And you can see the spectacular result that's come from that. We were, by the way, one of the first countries to do that. Lead in paint and plumbing, well, not quite so good a story there, because more money is involved, unfortunately. The scientific basis for it is very, very strong. I don't think there's any real doubt about the dangers that we're facing. But what our policy has been is to manage the problem instead of solving the problem, because we decided it was too expensive to remove the lead from all the paint and to remove the lead service lines. So really the fundamental question that we're facing is, how much is our health, and particularly our children's health, actually worth? We're making some decisions about that today that I would argue are not as good as the way we used to make decisions. Institutional structures, and we're just spending too much time penny pinching when we should be spending money making our lives better. Institutional structures and regulation, how do we ensure that we have fair and appropriate policies and practices nationwide? How much do we leave to local regulators, places in Michigan that are trying to save a few dollars? EPA simply doesn't have control over those things. People imagine that they do, but actually EPA, in my opinion, is a fantastic agency, and it is being blamed for all kinds of things that is not its fault, that are not its fault, and it doesn't have the authority to do the job that it needs to do in many cases. And I would argue clearly in the case of lead in water, we really need to revamp that and think seriously about it. That won't happen unless there's public understanding and engagement. There's no question. I've shown you many examples, both the action of consumers and turning away from spray cans, the action of people in Flint in actually making things known and making sure that their voices were heard. Should have happened a lot faster, wouldn't have happened at all without them. So certainly public understanding and engagement is absolutely critical. If we want a nation in which our environmental quality is better, we have to demand that. So thank you for your attention. I'll be happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
So just because it's easier and we only have one mic and we're trying to get all this stuff, so if you have a question, just please stand up and speak clearly and maybe even give your name.
The question is, I said that I didn't think we were as in touch with the environment as we used to be. There's an easy answer, which is that maybe we're just too busy and we spend too much time on our phones, you know. There's a group of people called No Child Left Inside, whose goal is really to get kids out and in nature and actually thinking about what a very special place this earth actually is. So I think those are some of the easy answers to it. I think another thing that has played a big role is that we feel we've lost somehow the feeling of empowerment. You know, in the 70s, people actually thought they could demand stuff, and they did, you know. And we got some stuff done. We got legislation against smog, for example, against acid rain, against chlorofluorocarbons. All those things happened because public opinion was very strongly in favor of environmental action. Now, you know, we're privileged to live in a state where I think there is more concern than there is in many parts of the United States. But somehow we've got the feeling now that nothing that we do or say will actually affect what happens. And I don't think that's true at all. And I think we have to actually ensure that we spend the time to make our voices heard. When you talk about climate change, I think it's true that until young people like you get really mad, nothing's going to happen. You got to get mad. Good. He said he was good at it. That's good. I know the hour is late. Maybe we'll just take one more question, if anyone has one. Yes, go ahead.
Are there any water filtration technologies, say, at the faucet, that could be used as a stopgap measure?
Yes. If you go to that site, just Google Scientific American interview Mark Edwards. He talks about that, and he actually gives there's a number of the type of whole house filter that you can get that will eliminate the lead. He's tested it, he's confident in it. So I would go with, I mean, I'm not a pipe corrosion expert, he is. Scientific American interview Mark Edwards, whole house filter, and you'll find out which one he says is the one to get. Thank you.
So that was a great lecture. I sat in the back and I just thought, I know entirely too much about this, the lead side of it, not only because it's been in the newspaper, but you'll be happy to know in Lawrence we're spending over $60 million to replace the pipes in our streets. That's why the streets are always busted up. And they're not using metal, they're using some type of plastic protrusion thing, I don't know. It's a lot of money. So we are definitely doing it. And you'll be happy to know the Senate just passed funding of this thing called SRF funding, which allows us to finance the building of the pipes. And this is extremely expensive, like I just said. And so they're giving us the ability to finance it cheaper, and they usually just give us back 75% of what we spend. So even though we're spending $60 million, we're probably not going to have to actually pay $60 million. So that's a good thing. And I only know that because I don't often get phone calls from Senator Markey, and he called me today telling me that this SRF funding passed. You have to go to the Ferris Park and just go to the top of that hill and see the vista. And you don't have to do it during the daytime too. Just at dusk is great. A lot of pictures being taken up there. It's beautiful. We had our first jazz and poetry event there. And even usually when sometimes it's a little dirt and trash inside the canal. There was actually this beautiful bright green algae growing in there, and it's just, I'm not sure if it's supposed to naturally happen that way, but it looked pretty. It did look pretty. So go and enjoy it, and I think it'd be great. And I think it would be, I think it's important for us to end, like we began, with our friend Chad. Chad?
Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Dr. Solomon. This was a very good start to the annual lecture series.
Golden Lake, sanctuary, state of grace. I will find reason, a place to begin.